Hello, ladies and gentlemen, I'm TWK Reviews, and welcome to another video where I, as a dream fanboy, over a video game. This time we're talking about Mystical Ninja starring Goemon. But before we talk about that, a thank you to all my Plus Ultra patrons over at patreon.com/TWK Reviews. Anyways, now onto this video game, which is both developed and published by Konami! Yeah, you remember them. Remember when Konami was Konami and made video games? But then Konami ended up going from being Konami to being Konami, and we all hate Konami, so now Jim Sterling came up with a really fancy hashtag. There it is, right down below. That is what our description is of modern-day Konami. Ooh, I really miss the Konami of this era. You know, the one that gave us so many innovative games. Ugh, I can words. I can totally words today. In fact, I'm going to words all about this game right about now. Our game's plot goes thusly. A group of villains by the name of the Peach Mountain Shoguns want to turn Japan into their own personal stage, and it's up to Goemon and company to stop them. That company, of course, consists of our hero Goemon, whom is the ultimate paragon! Abizumaru, the mischievous lover of food, yay, a literal secret agent ninja! And finally we have the naive clockwork ninja Sasuke. And like any well-made game, each of the four characters have their own abilities to add a tad of variety to the gameplay. Goemon can turn into a lawyer-friendly version of a Super Saiyan to move metal blocks as well as double his attack power at the cost of defense, of course. Abizumaru can shrink to get through tiny doorways, and not the most useful ability, quite situational. Yay can turn into a mermaid to navigate underwater areas, and I think this is one of the more useful abilities. And Sasuke can absolutely murder any difficulty platforming gave us. I guess this is why we don't get it until before the final area. Speaking of which, I guess just note that the platforming isn't exactly the best, as they say. It's mostly passable, but easily far from any type of selling point this game has. This might seem like a deal breaker due to how much platforming is in this game, but this game's strengths more than make up for its shortcomings. For example, the writing! Yes, comedy is extremely subjective. In fact, some might say it's the most subjective of all of the things, but Mystical Ninja's usage of purposefully lame wordplay, hidden in plain sight adult humor, and unique flashing text all add up to a hilarious game, in my opinion. On top of that, each of the game's dungeons, referred to here as castles, are beyond aesthetically pleasing. My personal favorite of these is the gourmet submarine castle, which is exactly as it sounds. We've got oversized food of dang near every culture, which is a nice look, but my love for it comes from its design. You see, there's a few areas that seemingly loop around, so if you're not good at keeping your bearings, you'll probably get lost pretty quickly, but thankfully I somehow avoided that this time around, so yay for me finally progressing after playing this game for almost 20 years. Mystical Ninja's bosses, however, can be a bit on the lacking side. The first one can be beat without even moving for once. Like, what's even going on here? The second is slightly more challenging, but just feels a bit more repetitive than anything else. As for the third and final boss, it's easily the most difficult, but that could just be my bad timing, so your mileage may vary on this one. Regular boss fights aren't the only thing Mystical Ninja has going for it, as when the need arises, Goemon and company can summon upon the Tokurific robot, Impact, who's introduced via song every single time. And no, I personally never get tired of it. I also never get tired of these robot battles themselves. Each boss has its own strategy that must be overcome, but I usually just blast them away with a charge beam, which takes a little under a fifth of their health. My favorite of these battles is against the final boss of the entire game, and I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, Tetua. It feels every bit as epic as any final boss should, and the fact that it's in space does not hurt my opinion of it either. This brings us to our antagonists, Spring Breeze Danson and Tiger Lily, who literally just want to turn Japan into a giant Broadway-esque stage. There's literally nothing I could add to that which could make the premise sound more ridiculous than it already is. Speaking of ridiculous, the mini-games! These are the ways that our heroes gain their abilities. First is Ibesumaru, who has to eat a bunch of sweets without getting caught by that giant. Not too easy, not too difficult, it is the perfect one for the game to start you with. Next is Goemon's, which is the most tedious of the bunch, since all you have to do is throw boxes onto the enemies and keep them from popping any of the balloons for 99 friggin' seconds. I always loathe doing this. Thankfully, Yaze follows that one, and all you gotta do is button mash. If you can do that, then going up the waterfall will be a cakewalk for you. Finally, we got Sasuke, who has to perform awkward platforming up a tower. How I got through this without running out of time is honestly beyond me. While all these minigames have their own flavor of jank, it's jank that I generally put up with and even enjoy to some degree. Staying on the topic of enjoyment, the towns! Each one is given their own aesthetic and dang do I enjoy every visit to them. Be it the starting town of Oedo, the always in Twilight Zazen? I'm gonna go with Zazen. The rural Folky Poke Village, or my personal favorite, Festival Village. This town combines my two favorite looks for an area, winter and night. The music doesn't hurt my opinion of it either. You may not have noticed this, but Mystical Ninja Star Goemon is kinda, sorta, really Japanese. Nowadays, we got games with Japanese culture coming out the wazoo, but back in the 90s, these weren't nearly as common. I should also note that this game was also my introduction to Japan in general, so you have this game to thank for me becoming the weeb that I am today. I really hope that through this video, you're all able to see why this game holds a special place in my heart, and I can only hope that one miraculous day, we see some sort of re-release of this game on some type of modern gaming platform. That would be nice, but then again, Konami is Konami, and Konami of today just won't let us have nice things, so until then, I'm going to continue playing this game until it no longer works. Thankfully, it doesn't have a save battery, but then again, I suppose my controller pack will eventually run out. Well, that's a dark thought. I'm going to go and do something happier.